Good afternoon, everybody. I hope you can hear me. You probably can't hear me, but maybe you can see me, that we're all wearing our headphones. And it's very important that you wear your headphones for this next session, which is an open forum organized by the Council of Europe and the Office of the High Commissioner of Human Rights on the right to privacy in the digital age. So I'm just looking around. I see people without headphones. I'm worried that you can't hear me, and therefore discussion will be a little bit limited. So please put your headphones on. Okay, thumbs up, headphones, good. Okay. So we're almost there. Okay, so I'm really hoping that you can hear me, because I don't hear very much, and we're going to start this session because we only have 1 hour together. We've got some great panelists and great introductory speakers. My name is Lee Hibada. I work at the Council of Europe, and the Council of Europe is an intergovernmental organization of 47 countries, which sits in Strasbourg in France, and we deal with things, amongst other things, of course, human rights, the rule of law, and democracy. And in that context, we have the European Convention on Human Rights and the European Court of Human Rights, which deal with, amongst other things, the right to freedom of expression and the right to private life, private and family life. And in those human rights, there are, you know, certain limitations, exceptions, which relate to national security, amongst other things. And that's part of the discussion that we're going to have today, which is about what is the state of play regarding mass surveillance, what progress has been made by governments, the private sector and civil society, and what next steps for privacy. And I'd like, first of all, to just pass to my colleague, Hernan Vales, to say a few words, and then we'll get going with the discussions. Hernan.
Thanks, Lee. Hello, everyone. My name is Hernan Vales. I work in the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. It's the main UN office with a responsibility to promote and protect all human rights for all everywhere. Let me tell you a little bit of what happened, why we're here, and what happened in terms of privacy in the UN in the last 2 years. You know, this is an open forum, so it's about telling you what our organizations have done and what they plan to do in the future. So we all know about the Snowden revelations in 2013, in June. In December of 2013, the UN General Assembly adopted a resolution asking the office where I work, the High Commissioner for Human Rights, to prepare a report on the right to privacy in the digital age. Also, the resolution, condemned mass surveillance and the impact it had on the right to privacy. So this resolution, this GA resolution, was quite novel. It was the first one of its kind. And as I said, asked for a report, which was submitted the following year, like in mid-2014. Both to the General Assembly and to the Human Rights Council. They are two different bodies of the UN that both deals with human rights in one way or the other. After this report was produced, and by the way, there are copies of the report at the end of this table in case you want to take one, the General Assembly met, adopted another resolution, this time asking the Human Rights Council to consider appointing a special rapporteur. You know, special rapporteur are independent experts which the Human Rights Council may appoint to look into certain issues. And they have a specific mandate. I'm sure Joe can talk about that later. So the Human Rights Council did indeed consider this possibility. And in fact, in March of this year, it adopted a decision creating the position of the special rapporteur on the right to privacy. This happened in June 2015, and in August 2015, Mr. Kanatachi here to my left started with his in his position as special rapporteur to the right to privacy. This is I'm giving you many dates and resolutions, but it's difficult to understand how fast the UN moved in on this particular issue. Things normally do not happen this fast. And at the UN or other international organizations. So there was obviously a lot of international pressure and interest for these things to move at the pace they did. I think now you are here to listen to the speakers and not to me and not to us who are here to moderate. And I'll start with asking a question to the special rapporteur, to Mr. Joe Canatacci. I don't think he needs any introduction, but you know, he's a special rapporteur on the right to privacy, appointed by the Human Rights Council, as I just said. He's also a professor at the University of Groningen and University of Malta. So, Joe, my question to you would be, mass surveillance continues to be a problem, right? We see laws like the bill in the UK, or the law that was adopted in France, that it's still permitting for mass surveillance to take place. So, have we made any progress? Where are we moving? And what are your plans for your mandate during the next 3 years?
Okay, thank you very much, Anand. To a certain extent, you'll have recognized that there are at least three questions over there. One which deals with mass surveillance, the other deals with the mandate and how we're going to tackle the mandate. And also, then, the third question is, have we moved on from where the United Nations have moved on? So I've prepared a little presentation to tackle two of these questions. The mass surveillance ones comes at the end. So I'll sit and stand. This, ladies and gentlemen, this is my third or fourth presentation of the day and my tenth of the week. So if you'll permit me, since it's the last one before you all go for dinner, you'll permit me to poke a little bit of fun at myself too, because otherwise if we take things too seriously, we'll go to sleep. So basically, I thought I'd rather start by telling you not who I am, but who I am not, right? And it's important to understand who I am not, right? So I'm not this guy, right? So I have no pretensions to be Superman. And I did, when I was offered this, I did think, hey, is this going to be Mission Impossible, right? So, to a certain extent, then I'm not this guy either, you know. It's up to you to decide who's the better looking one between the two. But hey, let's not go there, right? All I do know is that if you look upon it, it could be Mission Impossible rather than Mission Impossible, right? And let me try to tackle it in that way, perhaps. So, put yourself in my shoes, right, at this moment in time. We have a right to privacy, but we don't have a real consensus on what that means. What does privacy mean? Does privacy mean the same thing in France as it means in Brazil or in other countries? What precisely does it mean? And more than that, we have no mechanisms to enforce remedies for the global citizenry, whom I am supposed to protect, right? So what am I going to do? And this is not the first time you've heard me say this, and it's not going to be the last time, but in an internet without borders, what I think we need and what everybody tells me we need, this is the only thing that people can agree upon to a certain extent, is we need safeguards without borders, and we need remedies across borders, right? And this is something which I have taken very much to heart. So I look at my job as that also of a pathfinder, to help identify a way forward on many fronts, and identifying urgent issues which need to be tackled, and also reacting to the needs of individuals or of countries who require urgent work in my sector of responsibility. Yeah, okay, once again, this kind of shows you how old I am, because in my days, Superman was all the rage, and we used to watch these cartoons. And Superman was supposed to be the man with a plan, right? So, to a certain extent, Henan was asking me, do you have a plan? How do you plan to tackle the next 3 years? Okay, so I have the beginnings of a plan. And I say the beginnings because, as I've said before, I want to spend a lot of time listening to people to tell me what they want, right? I want to listen to all the stakeholders. I want to listen to the man in the street. I would like to listen to the civil society and NGOs. I like to listen to the parliamentarians, to police forces, to security services. All of these have legitimate interests and their own perspective. And I think part of my role is also building bridges between those. So I'd like to tackle this first point here. And I'd like to, before I go to the plan or the beginnings of a plan, and I'm telling you about the plan because I want you to tell me what you think about it, and I want you to tell me what I'm leaving out. And I want to make it quite clear that these are not listed in a list of priority, right? This is not a prioritized list. This is just a list. I could have started a number 10, and perhaps some of you might think I should start a number 10. And this is what I want to listen to you about. So the first thing that I think I have to work upon is a more detailed and a more universal understanding of what is meant by the right to privacy, right? What are the core values, and also what are those parts of privacy which belong to cultural differences, and which are privacy neighboring rights, as we would call them. A second thing which I think I have to do is work on awareness buildings, especially among citizens, right? What the rights are, but also what technology does to those rights and the impact of technology on those rights. A third thing, which is one of the reasons why I'm here at IGF 2015, is that I'd like to see a more structured, more open, more comprehensive, more effective, and most importantly, an ongoing permanent dialogue between the different stakeholders. And why am I saying that, ladies and gentlemen? Because when you look around us, this is supposed to be a multi-stakeholder assembly. But in reality, if you went to the session at 12 noon, which dealt with law enforcement, there weren't many people from law enforcement, right? When you go to, and obviously you would tell me, if there are people here from the secret services, they're secret, they're not telling us, right? But apart from that, we also have to look at the words structured, ongoing. I don't think meeting once a year is enough, frankly, right? And I think we have to get a much more intensive work going. I'm flicking, there we are. As I've said, the fourth thing we need to identify together are clearer and more effective safeguards which prevent infringement of privacy. And then, if you have an infringement, we must move to real remedies in those cases where an infringement actually occurs. A fifth part of what I'm considering my 10-point plan is developing effective technical safeguards, not relying on the law alone, but also working on technical safeguards, including encryption, including overlay software, as I tend to call it. I've just come from a session where we're dealing with a dynamic platform, a forum on building in safeguards into the technical platform itself, and various other technical solutions. The sixth is a more effective dialogue with the corporate world, right? Where current business models, where personal data has been heavily monetized. So I was delighted that in the previous session we were there together with, for example, Google, where we started part of the dialogue. And I should like to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that before I was ever appointed Special Rapporteur on Privacy, I had also, especially in things like the mapping project and several other projects, started a very effective dialogue with some of the larger companies and many of the smaller ones too. And we now hope to increase that, because it's very important that we understand that the corporations are also very important stakeholders there. The point I'd like to make is also pay close attention to the value of national and regional development in privacy protection mechanisms, right? So if, for example, I'm looking at national laws, and then I look in the context of Europe at the Council of Europe's Convention 108, And if I also you look at the EU directive for 4695, we have to realize the impact that these regional solutions have had on the development of privacy protection in that part of the world, Europe. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that everything that Europe has done is fine or is adequate or appropriate, but it's certainly quite a lot, and I think that there might be some good practices which we can pick up from European developments over the past 40 years too. The 8th point that I, part of my plan, is of course harnessing the energy and influence of civil society. I think that it's a very important stakeholder. As I said, I include this together with my previous one, where if you notice, I'm talking about three: a more structured, more open, more comprehensive, more effective, and most importantly, an ongoing permanent dialogue. And what do I mean there? I mean that, especially when I go and speak with the with civil society, especially I find that civil society sometimes is very suspicious of law enforcement and sometimes also of intelligence services. And sometimes one can understand why. You know, civil society is not happy that this is on occasionally being spied upon by some forms of security services. I should, of course, take this opportunity to make, especially as I'm going on to my 9th point, cyberspace. When we're talking about cyberspace, and here at IGF, cyberspace is our main concern. Remember one thing, as Special Rapporteur on Privacy, I am not only concerned with cyberspace. I'm concerned with privacy wherever it is, in whatever form, in whatever guise, offline and online. But here we're talking about the online world. And in the online world, when we come to mass surveillance, I'd like, first of all, to make a clear distinction between law enforcement and national security. This is one thing that many citizens don't realize. But in actual fact, in most countries, not all, but in most countries, the powers of law enforcement agencies, the police, as we would call them in most countries, is seriously curtailed. They do not have the right to carry out mass surveillance. They do not carry out mass surveillance. I think that's an important point which we need to keep in mind. Whereas on the other hand, it's agencies and security agencies which are normally tasked with surveillance for internal security and national security. And that at this moment in time, it is a minority of countries where mass surveillance, and a very small minority of countries. Out of 194 countries, we don't have that many countries. Some people say 15, some people say 17, but it's certainly not the 194 countries which make up the United Nations. My final point, ladies and gentlemen, it deals with a further development of international law, which legal instrument. I've spoken about this several times over the past 2 days, so I won't go very deep on this. I just like to say, though, that I am not wed to any particular legal instrument. In other words, and my friends from the Council of Europe will especially understand this, there are many forms of legal instruments which we can use, and some of them may be more appropriate to the timing of the action than others. We have recommendations, we have treaties, etc. And we may decide to take some of the problems in one treaty, and some in another treaty, and some not in a treaty at all, but in a recommendation. And what I would like to do over the next 2 to 3 years is kick off a proper discussion about which legal instrument is most appropriate to be used. My final slide, we have some very thorny problems in international law which we need to deal with. Jurisdiction, we've been here at IGF for 10 years now, we haven't solved problems on jurisdiction, although there are some interesting initiatives there. Territoriality, enforcement, clear international agreement about the mechanism for enforcing principles across borders, and of course life is becoming more complex with sovereignty in cyberspace, monkey business in cyberspace, as I like to call it, cyber war, cyber espionage. I'm stopping here, ladies and gentlemen. You can find me in various places on the internet, and I just hope that during the rest of the session we'll have more time also for more discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Joe. That was excellent. A lot of work for the future, I think. Thank you, Joe. A lot of work for the future, certainly, for OHDHR, for the UN agencies. I want to mention that I'm going to pass the floor to my colleague Gunter Schumann now from the Parliamentary Assembly. But just to say that the Council of Europe has been equally very busy in the field of looking at mass surveillance. We have there's a report of the Parliamentary Assembly, which is at the desk at the end of this table with a yellow cover, which is very interesting and very interesting to, if you really are interested in the issues in more detail, please take a copy. The Council of Europe, I expect, will carry on looking at the question of mass surveillance in the future, perhaps steward debate on this issue in the future, perhaps as part of a new internet governance strategy for the next 4 years for the organisation. But Gunter, now if I could pass it to you, could you tell us more about the report, the parliamentary perspective of Peter Omsic, to the rapporteur, please? Thank you very much.
Well, Joe just spoke of Mission Impossible, or Mission Possible. Peter Omsic, the Parliamentary Assembly's rapporteur, who is a Dutch Christian Democrat, achieved a Mission Impossible by getting a very progressive resolution through an assembly of parliamentarians, national parliamentarians from 47 European states, which tend to be very hard to get for human rights friendly positions. Peter achieved that aim. The resolution has some almost revolutionary statements, which were adopted by a fabulous majority in this representative body representing lawmakers from our 47 countries. For example, the Assembly recognized mass surveillance as a danger for fundamental human rights, not only rights to privacy, freedom of information, freedom of expression, but also rights to fair trial, rights to freedom of religion. Even lawyers and ministers, religious ministers, can be subject to surveillance. It's even a threat to the right to fair and free elections when free speech is impeded. The Assembly also now calls for laws, national laws in the very first place, which govern the behavior of national authorities, laws allowing for the collection and analysis of personal data, including the so-called metadata, only with the consent of the person concerned or following a court order granted on the basis of reasonable suspicion of the target being involved in criminal activity. So that's an analogy to analogous means of communication, which has now been stated in a very strong way. The Assembly actually calls for penalizing breaches of privacy on the internet in the same way as the violation of traditional confidentiality of correspondence. And now, and this is an idea, the next two ideas actually are derived from a hearing before a committee with a former head of the German Bundesnachrichtendienst, the German equivalent of the CIA, Professor Geiger, who suggested that there should be a multilateral intelligence codex negotiated between like-minded countries, not only those of the Council of Europe, but I'm sure Brazil or other countries would be interested in joining such a club, which this codex should include a mutual engagement to apply the same rules to the surveillance of each other's citizens as those applied to their own, and to exclude the use of surveillance for political, economical, or diplomatic purposes between participating states, to start with. The second and almost more revolutionary idea coming from a practitioner, a recently retired head of a surveillance agency, said that to help enforce any legal framework that member states are invited to enact, whistleblower protection is the key. The sword of Damocles, as Professor Geiger said, of protected disclosures of wrongdoings is the best deterrent. So In consequence, the Assembly also called for asylum to be granted to whistleblowers who expose unlawful surveillance if they are threatened by retaliation in their home countries. The Assembly has recently adopted a separate report, also this year, improving whistleblower protection, also by Peter Omtzigt, where a case study, which is part of the report, clearly shows that Edward Snowden fulfills the criteria set by the Assembly, advocated by the Assembly for whistleblower protection. We were very happy to see that only last week the European Parliament came to the same conclusion. Now, the Assembly also explicitly opposes backdoors. As a matter of human rights principle, no need to explain that, but also as a matter of common sense. Experiments by some of the experts that we have relied on show that backdoors can be quite easily identified and exploited by cyber criminals. The next generation of terrorists may well prefer bringing down our banking system and electricity supply with potentially far more disastrous consequences than, you know, somebody blowing himself up in the market square. The second to final point is that the Assembly insists that parliamentary and judicial oversight of surveillance must be strengthened, including, and that's a very important point, given that different countries are developing their own oversight bodies, parliamentary or judicial or a mix, in their own countries for their own services. But these oversight bodies should cooperate among themselves in the same way as the surveillance agencies cooperate among themselves. These like-minded countries, and that should be in this future codex, intelligence codex, like-minded countries, in order to make such oversight effective, should waive the originator control principle on a mutual basis for purposes of oversight. Now, the Assembly, and that is a word creation by Peter Omtzigt, the Assembly is worried about the growth of the surveillance industrial complex, which is fostered by the culture of secrecy and the highly technical nature of surveillance operations. Both the seriousness of threats and the costs and benefits of specific countermeasures are difficult to assess for lay persons, non-techies. Policymakers are therefore obliged to rely on input from the interested groups themselves. And these powerful structures risk escaping democratic control and accountability. Now, the recent trend of outsourcing and privatization of surveillance activities only adds to the wrong incentives, where there may actually be financial, monetary incentives for growing the surveillance sector, where people can earn a lot of money by almost blackmailing decision makers, political decision makers, budgetary decision makers, into allocating more and more resources to this sector, which is threatening to spiral out of control in certain countries. Finally, and last but not least, independent reviews, including one commissioned by no less than the US president, have shown that mass surveillance has not contributed to the prevention of terrorist attacks. It's ineffective, contrary to assertions by intelligence officials. Instead, these reviews have shown that resources that might otherwise have prevented attacks are diverted to mass surveillance, and which leaves potentially dangerous persons free to act. The famous quote by a former deputy head of the US NSA, if everything is a target, nothing is a target. So in a nutshell, the Assembly, whilst waiting for the proposals it has made to be implemented, a legal framework to be created that will be properly enforced by strong whistleblower protection and oversight mechanisms that cooperate with one another, whilst waiting for all this to happen, maybe with the help of Joe it'll happen more quickly than we are pessimistically estimating at the moment, whilst waiting, the Assembly advocates to promote pervasive encryption, end-to-end encryption, as a matter of informational self-defense, where encryption will then basically oblige intelligence agencies to concentrate on high-value targets, because they cannot simply not, they do not have the resources necessary to hack everyone's and anyone's well-protected server. Pervasive encryption and the decentralization of the internet by having local servers instead of a very small number of very large servers is the answer, the temporary answer that the assembly gives: mass encryption as a response to mass surveillance. Obviously, you all know this recommendation by the assembly is at the moment not followed by several of the main biggest member states of the Council of Europe, which are adopting or have adopted laws allowing mass surveillance far beyond the recommendations of the assembly, and even are considering prohibiting or severely limiting encryption and or mandating rather than forbidding backdoors. I think that's a start for a discussion that we can have with our other colleagues. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Günther. That was very interesting to see what the Council of Europe Parliamentary Assembly is doing. I'd like to move now to the other speakers and maybe start with Mr. Alexandre Pena Gisleni. Mr. Gisleni is Director of the Human Rights Department in the Brazilian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Itamaraty. Mr. Gisleni, I mean, we all know that Brazil was at the forefront of this movement for privacy in the international plane, together with Germany and other states. And now you got what you were looking for. You have the special rapporteur. So I'll ask you a few questions. First, what are your expectations for the mandate of the rapporteur? And also, what else now? What will be Brazil's role from now on?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I'd like to first of all to thank the Council of Europe and the Office of the High Commissioner for holding this event. I mean, this is a great initiative. It takes us human rights people outside of the Human Rights Council room and makes us enlarge the circle of our interlocutors, which is great. And this is particularly relevant in our case, and I'm coming to your questions. We do not believe that we have got what we were looking for. What we are looking for is a solid foundation to tackle the right to privacy challenges in the long term. And the establishment of a mandate of a special rapporteur was a great step forward. We believe that it might even in the future be viewed as a leap forward, but it's far from being enough. And I am on a light note, I am glad that I can follow from the intervention made by our special rapporteur, because I actually share many of his concerns. There is, if I can establish a short, quick dialogue with him, I believe that we can work on an agenda. But our special rapporteur is focusing on the empty half of the cap, and maybe we should, first of all, take a quick look at the full half of the cup, which is right to privacy is, as a matter of fact, international law. It's the law of our world. And why do I say that? It's enshrined in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which has been ratified by 168 countries. And we might ask us, so what about the remaining countries? Well, all remaining countries recognize the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which also enshrines the right to privacy. So we have the norm. We have a foundation, a basis to work on. And another achievement that we have made in the past few years is that we have
brought the right to privacy out of its oblivion and into the center stage of the human rights debate, and in a consensus basis. And this is very important. I'm not saying that you have unanimity. I don't believe in unanimity. But we do have a large majority of countries, and I speak for one, which believe that this is a major issue to be dealt with. So let me go to the challenges that have been listed by our special rapporteur. The first question that, and I'd like to address his provocation on Mission Impossible. This mission is going to be possible or impossible based on two criteria. First of them is in what time frame. If we manage to sort out all the problems listed by a special rapporteur in 3 years, we are all going to run for a Nobel Prize. I'm pretty sure of that. But but time is of the essence, but it's also part of the United Nations work. We have taken over 20 years to get the international covenants. The International Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples took longer than that. I'm not saying that you're going to take 20 years, but we have to go through the phases and with a steady look at what we are looking for. And this goal is clear, it is set, it is in his mandate. So let me get to the second challenge that we have, which is to keep the achievements, to keep our acquis onusien, if I can say that, the French phrase. And in order to do that, consensus or a large majority of supporters is key, is central. This is fundamental. And this is something that encompasses not only governments, which of course is a major issue, but encompasses all the stakeholders. What you need to do next is to improve the international system, and I'm talking about the international human rights system, in order to incorporate all these interlocutors, all these stakeholders, into a discussion. I'm glad that the special rapporteur raised this issue as his number three concern. So this is, we have a number of challenges. The first of them is to bring all the complexity of this issue to the human rights dimension, to the Human Rights Council of the United Nations. I believe that in this very IGF, we can see its complexity as we talk about the right to privacy from internet governance perspective. This is not something that delegates in Geneva have in mind, at least at the Human Rights Council. And this is something that we should bring to our attention. So, very shortly, sir, I believe that we can continue our discussion later on. But I would just like to share this. What seems to be an overwhelming challenge is actually something to be welcome. We did not have this challenge 2 years ago. Now we do. And this is an improvement in itself. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gisleni. We will now give the floor to the next speaker. This is Ms. Carly Neist. Carly used to be the legal director of Privacy International, but now is independent human rights consultant on all things tech and human rights, as she says in her Twitter account. Carly, you were obviously very involved as part of civil society also in the process that led to the appointment of the special rapporteur and on privacy issues in general. But you know, the current situation shows that we have a special rapporteur, but at the same time we have court decisions also that obviously say that mass surveillance is wrong, but we have state practice which is not really going hand in hand with those court decisions. So where do you see consensus emerging?
Thanks, Anand. I'll speak very quickly because I'm interested to hear what the audience thinks as well. But I'm not a diplomat, so I'm not going to be diplomatic, unlike the previous speakers. And I will say that from my perspective, things couldn't be any worse, to be honest. And I think that we really need to recognize the very real challenge that we're facing at the moment, particularly when it comes to mass surveillance. And that is the very calculated legitimization of mass surveillance by a number of very key and powerful governments. I very much respect the Special Rapporteur's positive spin on things, but in fact, I think the challenge is far greater, perhaps, than he leads us to believe, and requires a lot more potentially offensive tactics to really try to establish norms around mass surveillance. Because from where I sit, I live in the UK, although I'm Australian, and I see the UK government trying to legitimise, and in very detailed and frank and honest and banal terms, the use of what is by any other name mass surveillance, but which they call bulk interception of communications. And I think we're at a point now where we're really in the process of crossing the Rubicon. I think it's one thing for mass surveillance to take place behind closed doors and for everybody to deny they're doing it. But when states start to admit that they're doing it and start to justify it on the basis of international law and other principles, I think that's when we get into really dangerous territory. And certainly from an international law perspective, those of you who know about how law becomes customary international law, the fact that we see states avowing these practices and defending them is a really frightening turn of events. And I think that I don't see governments are going to be the leaders in this field, and I don't necessarily feel that the public at large has enough of a grasp of the issues and understanding of the real implications to be the key players in this. I think that it is the international institutions like the ones we have represented here and the courts which are going to be the leaders in this field, and they're going to be the ones who draw the line in the sand. You know, the Schrems decision by the Court of Justice of the European Union was a huge step forward, a recognition that mass surveillance, generalised access to content of communications, impairs the essence of the right to privacy. That's such an important recognition. And I think the more we see institutions like those represented here backing that claim and saying mass surveillance can never be proportionate, no matter how severe the terrorist threat is, no matter how many laws you have to safeguard the use of that that tactic, it can never be proportionate. Then I think until that happens, we're still in danger of this really coming to kind of set us in a very bad trend for the next few years. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Carly. We're now going to pass to Gbenga Sesan from the Paradigm Initiative in Nigeria, another part of the world. This is a global dialogue. Gbenga, what happens, Gbenga, when you don't have necessarily a framework, like a data protection framework, a law in place in a country, you know, to give you the safeguards that you need to ensure that, you know, private life is respected? That's the case, I think, in your country and in other countries. I think even in this country we're in now. So please say some words. Thank you.
I was beginning to get concerned if we were talking about the same world in terms of surveillance. So I'm glad, you know, you made that point, because things are really terrible. I mean, to say the least. There are many countries where governments are basically making up the laws as they go. There are no frameworks in place. They just many countries claim, my country, for example, between 2013 and 2015, invested in mass surveillance equipment in the name of terrorism. And projects were implemented, and it was only after the equipment was bought that government began to talk about laws. That was when the regulator then began to try the backdoor approach of using a regulation, which definitely is not primary legislation, trying to use a regulation to then provide a backdoor for the government to be able to do mass surveillance. So I think things are really bad in the sense that many governments do not agree that mass surveillance is something they shouldn't look at. Many governments believe that this is the way to keep the people safe, or at least the excuse of keeping the people safe. And I think it goes on to the issue specifically, if I want to talk about the issue of data privacy in Nigeria, for example, there's 7 government agencies that collect biometric data. And Nigeria does not have data privacy laws. Earlier today, we were having a conversation, and there are, of the 54 countries on the African continent, there are less than 10 that have privacy laws, data privacy laws. And if you're collecting biometric data, so I'll give you a very good example. In 2016, Nigeria is going to have a census, and the Census Commission is already saying that to be sure that we're counting people properly, we would also collect biometric information. And so you have all this proliferation of biometric data without data privacy laws. And I think that the problem we have is that many governments are making up the rules as they go, and things are not, we can try to look at them in a nice way, but things are not nice at all. And I think I'll just end with this to say that while we have those problems, one of the things that we are doing at the moment in Nigeria is to also use the approach of the government. If you're trying to use laws to cause trouble, then maybe we can also use laws to find a solution. And what we are doing is we're proposing a positive rights bill, basically, that protects the rights of citizens and also uses the same process of legislation that government uses to encode and, or, you know, to basically codify these rights for citizens. So things are grim, things are tough, and thanks, you know, to many people who are working across the world to make sure that these issues are brought to the fore. But unfortunately, we have a lot of governments that do not believe that this is an issue that they shouldn't look at, and many that are making up the rules as they go. And this is really dangerous, because they would find excuses, usually terrorism is one, and then they will do the things they want to do anyway. Thank you.
Thank you, Gebenga. That was excellent. I think that's been a series of really excellent interventions. So thank you all. We also have a remote moderator, Emilia Vushi. I don't see where she is, but she might be maybe at the back. And I'd like to give you a thumbs up if there are any remote interventions. I don't see you, so please signal to me if you have any interventions. Sorry? She's in the cabin. So if she's in the cabin, how can I see? Lorena, I don't know. Okay, let's carry on. This is a dialogue. We only have in the region of about 10 or 12 minutes left, because we have only an hour together. So we're going to terminate around about 18:35. I'd like to start thinking about going to the microphones and asking your questions. As you mentioned, I think one of the interventions was mentioned, these organizations, the organizations like the Council of Europe and UNHCR, Joe Canatacci, we are here to also to take things back to our organisations and to carry on discussing and ensure that, you know, we feed in that dialogue into reflections. I mean, there's a mandate, and there's mandates for the future to unfold, and this is a chance for you, I would say, really a chance for you to try to have your voice heard in international discussion on mass surveillance, on the right to privacy. So I would really ask you to step up to the mics and to say what you think. Are there any comments? Does anybody want to come, please? Please, you, please. It's the, come to the mic, please. Thank you. Your name, but she can't hear me. Your name. Oh. Your name, please.
Can the technical crew please put the slider up on the mic? Thank you.
Is it working now?
Yes.
Okay. So my name is Yolanda Mlonzi from the Association for Progressive Communications, and I'm based in South Africa. So my question just goes from the context of Africa, where we have a lot of problems apart from privacy and surveillance. So how do we make Africans understand what surveillance is and how it impacts them and their privacy? I think at this moment it's a conversation and a debate where we have the IGF, but most people are outside of this conversation, and how can we bring them in to understand these type of issues? Thank you.
My name is Anya Mir. I represent the Center on Governance Through Human Rights. A question to the UN Special Rapporteur. I was very impressed by all the efforts that you undertake, particularly in dialoguing, and I think it's absolutely fundamental, dialoguing with all the different stakeholders. But it wasn't really clear to me what the agenda is you dialogue about, whether it's, you know, how these different agents and governments, private companies, whatever, how they want to implement the right to privacy, what their ideas is, what is the agenda? I mean, you were honest enough at the beginning to say, well, you don't really have a plan. It's very difficult to have a plan at these times. But nevertheless, I'm sure there is sort of a vision ahead, and maybe you can elaborate a little bit more about this. Thank you.
I'm actually interested in giving answers to both questions, or not complete answers, but starting with answers. Let me start with the question about Africa.
I think that it's, in fact, 2 days ago, I spent 1.5 hours with people from Africa. We were discussing the subject in a fair amount of detail. And I think that there are a number of ways, including awareness campaigns, including a whole string of activities which can be taken forward. So if you wish to speak to me after the session, I'll be very happy to tackle that and give you some more details on what we have, because I have been working in Africa too, and a number of things are of close concern, very close to my heart too. To come to the second point, the second lady who spoke and asked the question, so what's the agenda? I mean, to a certain extent, it's where do you start from, right? Because everybody wants to put their stuff on the agenda. But let's look at a few examples, right? Surveillance is on the agenda. And it's not as if we're coming unprepared to the debate. So if we're going to talk about surveillance, and I look at three things, and I'm just going to mention three things, I could mention 300. But let's start with three things. If I take the codex alone, which has been mentioned, so much work has gone into that already. And if we can take that work and push it forward as part of a well-thought-out structure, that's already a huge step forward. If we look at the work that has been carried out in two of the projects I have led in EU-funded research projects, and here I'm talking about SMART, which dealt with smart surveillance, and I'm talking about RESPECT. In those projects, we actually have produced a draft model law, which can be used in various ways. At national level, it can be used at international level, either in the form of a multilateral convention, in the form of a directive, if you use it regionally in the EU. What am I saying there? In those two projects alone, we have over 8.4 million euro worth of research on evidence-based research, which has produced a law specifically to producing safeguards. That law, that model law, was designed to produce safeguards. The agenda extends further. I have already started working. I've been working for 30 years now, trying to bring law enforcement and security services together into the debate and identifying what they really need. The agenda also extends to what Carly was saying. I wasn't trying to put a positive spin on anything, Carly, and I don't know why I came across or why you said what you did, but if you look carefully, including at the reports that have come out on Wired, I'm more than concerned. I'm very seriously concerned about those countries which are seeking to legitimize current regimes or current attempts. In what may be an honest, you use the word honest, but to my point of view, often misguided and unsubstantiated approach to mass surveillance. So in fact, some of the things that I have said while here at IGF have already produced considerable media reports over the past 48 hours, which show the level of my concern. I have said beyond scary, in more than scary, in one case. So I think that it's time limits that we have at this moment in time, which force me not to focus on that part too, and it's time limits which now make me shut up and give the floor to somebody else. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Joe. We really are on the last minutes. We have two more speakers, Mr. Fitchen from the German Cyber Foreign Policy, and then Giacomo Mazzoni from the EBU. Please, Mr. Fitchen, if you could keep it brief. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Although I would still be interested in your answer to the question from our colleague from South Africa, because that hasn't been answered. I just wanted to pick up maybe on your question, because Germany was one of the partners of Brazil in this resolution. Did we get what we wanted? And my colleague already said it. What we did get was really the consensus on the text. We managed to form a text that was not divisive on day one, because if you start with the debate with in irreconcilable positions on day one, we wouldn't have had Joseph Kanatachi at this table today with a clear mandate to go on. So in that sense, even though I admit that the situation may be less than good, but now we can set the ball rolling. And it's also important for other stakeholders, for civil society, for others who want to pick up and discuss it, for IGF even, because all of us can now rely on this consensus in the General Assembly and the Human Rights Council. You can hold your governments accountable to what they have said in those resolutions. So that legitimizes the debate and maybe an important feature. Thank you very much.
Very much. Giacomo, please, briefly.
Yes, just some suggestions. It works. Answering to the question is, no? Yes? The real solution for answering to this question is media literacy and digital literacy. And yesterday, I don't know if you noticed, but the president of the European Broadcasting Union, on behalf of the World Broadcasting Union, says that the broadcasters are ready to make campaign and to make awareness around the world about this kind of topics. It's simply a question of will, political will, that we need to find. The second thing is that I think that another way that need to be explored is work, instead of waiting for a treaty for the next 20 years, this scale of time worries me very much. Probably we need to start with voluntary agreement in the field. I just mentioned what we are doing within the EBU. We have a lot of data now using the information coming from the VOD and the access via broadband to our contents. A lot of data that we have to manage in a certain way. And we are trying to establish a code of conduct between our members how to treat this data. Because what is important for us is to better profile the information and to better service, provide a better service to the viewers and to the users, but not to know who want to go to Morocco or who want to buy a bottle of wine. So it's a totally different approach. I think that if there is a consensus between industry, between various stakeholders, we can go on voluntary basis quite soon. I think that waiting for a treaty, we will be all dead. I just remember you the economic value of what we are talking. In the last 2 years, there has been a shift in the advertising market in Europe. 20% of the market went to behavioral advertising. And behavioral advertising means one company that has private data of all European citizens. We have the data, but we cannot use because we are bounded by the European law, and we are happy to be bound by the European law. Somebody else not.
Thank you very much. We're really going to take the last two questions. I'm going to queue up Emiliar in the remote participation booth, who has a remote question. But first, you please, and then Emiliar. Thank you.
Is that working?
Yes.
That work? Yeah. I would like to ask. My name is Victor. I'm a researcher from the University of São Paulo. I would like to ask you, Alexandre, what is the efforts that the government of Brazil has been doing to reduce possible abuses from the Brazilian intelligence agency here in Brazil, and if they're, I don't know, making some laws to punish or don't allow abuses from our agency, like it's okay.
Thank you. Let me just take the second question before Mr. Gizzolini responds to that question. Emiliano, can you please give us your remote feed, please? They're telling it, yeah, please. Well, she's running, so I think they know that. No?
Lee?
Yeah?
While we wait for that, could I just come in very quickly with a clarification? Okay, so very quickly to respond to the last intervention on one point, it doesn't necessarily take 20 years to bring in a treaty. The Council of Europe has a record in certain areas I was personally involved not only for data protection since 1984-85, but the area of cybercrime, which is the only piece of international law governing cyberspace. We did that from 1996 till 2000, signed 2001, ratified by many other countries, including the United States, etc. So if my Metz is still intact at the end of a conference day, that's more like 4 to 5 years. Of course, it can take 20, but take heart from that in the sense that my examples would show you that soft law in the Council of Europe became hard law within 20 of it being adopted. And I think that if we can get decisions, treaties in important cases like climate change, which is what we're seeing after 20 years, and hopefully in Paris in December, we're going to see more progress, then I am actually quite optimistic that we can also, with goodwill, make slow but steady progress in the time frames. And I think the question of time frames is the right one. But the fact that my mandate is only 3 or 6 years doesn't mean that we don't start. Thank you.
Joe, Emilar, I don't have any response from Emilar. We really are running out of time, but I'd really like to go to Mr. Gisleni first of all to respond to Victor about the point about surveillance in Brazil, please.
Well, thank you very much. I'll give you a straightforward answer. To the best of my knowledge, there have been accusations against the Brazilian intelligence service that they have been following the work of social movements. But, well, first of all, that did not involve data collection or interception of any kind. And second of all, these accusations have not been proven. But so, in any case, if the our colleague Victor asked us what has been done to punish the culprits for that, there have been no condemnation so far, as far as I know.
Thank you, Mr. Gisleni. Emilar.
Okay.
Hello, we are not hearing. Okay, so this is a question from Tawanda Mugari from Zimbabwe. He's from the Digital Society Zimbabwe. And his question was, is it feasible to have mass encryption in mass surveillance countries, especially in developing countries where also surveillance is happening over telephone calls and SMS? So he wants to know if it's feasible to have something on mass encryption.
It is feasible even now, and it would be important to make these mass encryption technologies even more user-friendly than what they are now. I'll use the opportunity to reply to the question from the colleague from South Africa, why this mass surveillance issues are so important also for Africans. We have another report on targeted killings by drones where simple so-called metadata is used to target people, put the target on the back of people for rockets on the basis of who they call, how often and when, according to a point system, which has been commented on by a senior US official, saying, we kill on the basis of metadata. It's a quote in our report. And in the report on drones and targeted killings, it is warned against the trend that this may actually be automated, that this metadata can be used in an automatic fashion, in a robotized fashion, to target individuals without a trial, without even an accusation, on the basis of who they spoke to on the phone and when and how often. And that is something we have to, it's happening in developing countries, but those who do it are European countries, the US, and we have to have a global discussion to rein in on such practices, which become really totally incompatible with any human rights standards subscribed by the vast majority of all countries in the world. Thank you very much.
Maybe I can just speak, I can bring home that conversation about why Africans should be worried. If you run elections in country, and I'm sure you're given an example of South Africa, I'll give you an example of Nigeria, of Kenya, of Uganda, of countries where political opposition have been targeted and some of them have easily been arrested. As I speak to you, there are two bloggers who have been arrested, and you know, it's basic that we don't know when they will be released or if they will be released. We had a case of a guy who was arrested and for 21 days in Nigeria was exchanged between agencies, between security agencies. When we asked the security services, where is this guy? Is he with you? They would say no because they've passed him on to the other guy. We asked the second agency, they said no, pass on to the other guy. People are dying, people are lost, people can't be found, people are not coming home for dinner because somebody is targeting them with surveillance equipment and is not giving them a right to fair hearing in Africa, in countries where elections are held and opposition is seen as the enemy of the state.
Thank you very much, Kibenga. We have one intervention by Alex from Privacy International, and then I would like, just before you come to the mic, I'd like then to maybe bring the session to a close, but I would really like to invite perhaps Carly and other speakers to give just a very quick reaction or takeaway or say a few words to, before we come to the wrap up with Lorena, please. So Alex and then panelists and then Lorena. Thank you.
Just to reflect on different solutions that have been put forward during the discussions, I think something that I already mentioned on Monday in the other session on privacy and mass surveillance was the playing field is not equal. There's such a lack of transparency as to what governments are doing, the policies and their practices, and it's really being counterproductive to what, you know, we're trying to do in terms of advocating for better safeguards, for remedies, for better regulation of surveillance powers. And so that's probably one of the calls we would be asking for at the beginning, to have a, you know, equal playing field, and so that the information is out in the open. Information that should already be in the public eye, because it is in the public interest for that information to be available. I think that's a real hindrance to us going forward, is the lack of transparency of what is actually the state of affairs currently in terms of policies, but also practices.
Thank you very much. Okay, that's been a great discussion, great interventions. If I may, Carly, that's okay. Can we have just a quick reaction and then go around the panelists and then we conclude? Thank you.
Yeah, just one quick thought in reaction to my colleague from APC's comment about the sense of surveillance in Africa. I don't think it's the case that people in Africa don't understand surveillance. I think they understand well and truly what surveillance is and have had, of course, Africa is not a country, so we must talk about different African countries, but many countries in Africa have long histories of surveillance. I think the difference, though, is that digital literacy is an issue, but also people feeling the agency to engage with this issue and that they can do something about it. I think we see in many African countries, people just accept that they are under surveillance all the time, and it's a non-issue because they just accept it. So I think the thing that needs to change there is really giving people the feeling that they have the agency and the power to do something about it, that they can advocate vis-a-vis their governments and try and change things.
Mr. Gislini, do you want to say some final remarks before we conclude?
Sure, as shortly as I can. I just hope that this is not the last meeting that we want to have about this issue. Thank you.
Thank you. Ria?
Well, just to say that there's a lot of hypocrisy on the part of many governments. You know, when we talk about surveillance and security and the excuses that are given for it. And I think that if we're going to have a conversation, let's be honest, but it has to be the fact that citizens have to be respected in terms of their privacy and their rights.
Thank you. Gunther.
Well, we have seen that mass surveillance is a threat to human rights. It needs a legal framework to rein in mass surveillance, not laws to legitimize it. And this legal framework must be enforced by protecting disclosures of abuses by whistleblowers.
Thank you very much, Joe. Just very short.
Yes, I'll just simply endorse what all the previous speakers said. I've spoken more than long enough today, and I know there are a number of people who are going to keep me speaking here until way past dinner time, so I'll stop here. Thank you.
Okay, Lorena, can you? This is hard. This is a hard task. I've done this before. In a nutshell, can you give us a quick flash of information in conclusion?
I will try to do so. It's especially difficult since indeed it's not going to encompass all that has been discussed. But in a nutshell, I would say there is a common agreement on the need for action on different levels. With regards to governmental actors, there is a need at the regulatory level to create, first of all, an international common understanding of privacy on the first side. On the other side, there is a need for a harmonization of safeguards on, with regards to privacy regulation. On the enforcement level, again with regards to governmental actors, there is a need for an harmonization with regards to enforcement, real enforcement measures, and safeguards oversighting this enforcement. With regards to civil society, we've seen diverse voices demanding awareness campaigns, while at the other side, perhaps a need also for a way to formulate the way civil actors are feeling with regards to surveillance, since apparently we see that there are two different types of needs. On the one side, being aware, as I said, and on the other side, having the possibility to, once one is aware, to formulate these fears and these concerns. And with regards to all stakeholders, what we see is there is a need to have a multi-stakeholder dialogue to sharpen the diverse concepts on privacy on the one side, to understand the needs for legitimate security on the other side, as well as for prosecution, for legitimate prosecution, and also to have a common understanding between all stakeholders of what is needed to have a more democratic institutions with regards to security and the use of surveillance only under legitimate rules and grounds. That was pretty much it.
That is a nutshell. Thank you very much, Lorena. I'd like to conclude, but I'd like to pass the floor to Hernan. So, Hernan, thank you very much for the opportunity to co-organize this open forum. The last words are yours.
Well, it's late, so I'll be very quick. First of all, apologies for this room. I know it's not the, this is a room we got, but it's very strange. It's like the silent room when you're not wearing the things. But that was out of our control. So, you know, we had a very interesting discussion, and obviously the discussion needs to continue because we've made a lot of progress, but as it's evident from the questions and from the presentations that were made, much more needs to be done. So we need to keep moving forward. Thank you.